Hello and welcome to my channel. I'm Tiffany, a retired librarian turned homeschool mom. In this review, we're going to look at something very, very strange. Roald Dahl's Charlie and the Chocolate Factory. Now, I already did an introduction to talk about Roald Dahl and his issues. I also covered George's Marvelous Medicine several months ago. In fact, I think I covered it in September, along with this introduction. So now we're going to look at Charlie and the Chocolate Factory. We're going to look at the book. We'll deal with the films later. Hopefully there are going to be no more of them. I am going to actually cover Charlie and the Great Glass Elevator as well. Yes, that's a book. Yes, it's a thing. I haven't read it yet. I think I had it read to me as a child, but I'm going to reread it as I did with this one. I borrowed a copy from my public library in ebook form. So that's why I don't have a physical copy. The only Roald Dahl book I have in physical form is Witches, which I will cover at some point as well, and the film, and I don't know if I'm going to cover the modern thing. We'll get there. Let's focus on this thing. If you watched my other reviews on Dahl, Roald Dahl probably shouldn't have been writing children's books any more than Stephen King should be writing children's books. So, Roald Dahl is a very, very good horror author, and his books are very, very weird. Okay, so Charlie and the Chocolate Factory. Most people are more familiar with the films, so we're going to go over the books. So Charlie is, it doesn't specify where they're at. It never does in Dahl's books. His characters are very flat and ambiguous, so children can reflect themselves on them. So you have Charlie. He's very, very poor. His father works in a toothpaste factory, screwing caps onto filled toothpaste containers. His mother stays home with both sets of grandparents who pretty much lay in a bed all day. No, there's no explanations for, no, there's no logic behind this or explanations of how they're still alive and not covered in bed sores and all sorts of other issues. But they all share one bed. And that's the only bed in the house. The parents and Charlie sleep on mattresses on the floor in another room, which can get very, very cold. They're very, very poor, pretty much living in a shack. And Charlie gets a bar of chocolate every year for his birthday. Otherwise, they primarily eat cabbage soup and broth, and sometimes his parents go without food. So, yeah, they're very, very poor. And it tells the story of once this town had a chocolate factory, and still does, but one day, basically because people kept trying to steal his secrets, the owner, Willy Wonka, pretty much let everybody go and then shut everything down and disappeared for some time. And then all of a sudden, this factory turns back on. Nobody comes in, nobody comes out, and they see shadows of very short people inside. And so then all of a sudden, chocolate starts coming out. Nobody knows what's going on. And Charlie passes the chocolate factory every day on his way to school. He's an extremely, very, very poor boy. And they never really talk about his school life either. So then one day in the newspaper, Willy Wonka has announced that he is going to give out 5 golden tickets, and he's going to allow 5 children to come into his factory with their parents and tour the factory, and then they get a lifetime supply of candy from his factory at the end, and that's it. So you have kind of the introduction to each one of these characters. Prior to Charlie, you have, I think the first one, which is Augustus Gloop, who, yes, is a very, very spoiled fat boy and does nothing but eat, and his parents don't care. Then you have Veruca Salt, whose father owns a peanut factory and had his employees shuck chocolate bars to give his daughter a golden ticket, and she's a spoiled little brat, and I want everything. Then you have Violet Beauregard, who is the I choose chewing gum incessantly and kind of is spoiled and just talks about chewing gum all the time. And then you have Mike TV, who is obsessed with television, and that's it. And then you have Charlie. So each one of these kids finds a golden ticket. Charlie gets one. He finds money on the ground and goes in and buys 2 candy bars and gets that last ticket. And the basically guy who owns the candy shop realizes, yes, this is a very skinny boy. People are trying to steal this from him. It's like, go. He just helps him get out and like hold on to that because people are offering him money for it. And he's like, go home, run straight home. and he goes straight home. He has the golden ticket. He ends up going to the factory with his grandpa, Joe, who gets out of bed for the first time in God knows how long. And both of them are very, very thin. And so they go to the factory, and Wonka opens his door. He's kind of a quirky looking man and introduces himself to everyone and then brings them all in. And you kind of get twists and turns into the factory. And then they go into, and you see this in both the films. I actually described it, show it very, very well in the films. The, basically his candy garden with his chocolate water fountain. And that's where you first have the issue. So the Oompa Loompas. Oh dear. Hello, slavery. I'm not sure whether it's, people say it's African slavery. It's not African slavery. It's Aborigine slavery instead. This is not any better. Because he mentions, I can't remember what he mentions. He mentions something that implies, he mentions eucalyptus leaves. So that's how you know it's Australia. But again, he finds these short little people living up in trees, having to eat nothing but caterpillars. Otherwise, they're going to be eaten by these, some of these bizarre fishes, monsters. And they're miserable, and they're obsessed with cacao. It's like chocolate, which I don't think makes any sense, because I'm pretty sure chocolate originates in South America, not Australia. But doll is weird. And essentially, Willy Wonka's character convinces these leader to come and with all his entire tribe of people to come and live in his factory, and he will pay them in chocolate. And then he smuggles them into the country in boxes with holes in them, including men, women, and children. So there's that. And then he experiments on them. Yeah, he describes that in the factory as well. He experiments on them. He experiments his stuff on them. So, yeah, there are issues. There are lots of issues. Whether Dahl was racist or not, he probably was. I mean, he was, he worked for the Shell Oil Company and was kind of a part of Imperial Africa, north kind of Africa around the Kenya area and Tanzania. So yeah, that's an issue. Just a warning, that's an issue that is brought up. But back to the story. So you have the Augustus Gloop drinks the chocolate, falls in, nearly drowns, is sucked up a pipe, and his parents are taken off by the Oompa Loompas, who then proceed to, yes, they sing a song about Augustus Gloop and how he came to his end and how he was a spoiled brat. And then they move on. Yes, they take the boat, which is actually made of candy. And yes, Veruca Salt wants one. She also wants an Oompa Loompa. Like, she wants an Oompa Loompa. Tying to, again, slavery things. Like, you can't, basically, she's trying to buy people. Wonka didn't exactly buy people. He lured them with chocolate and indentured servitude for chocolate and then experimenting on them. Moving on. So they go through, he does sing, they see a bunch of doors, they pass by things in the boat, the little rowboat, and then it's made of candy. And yes, he has to tell them not to lick it because they make it sticky. And then they get through the inventing room and eventually the gum situation, basically different things going on. And yes, this is where he explains he experiments on his Oompa Loompas. And then Violet Beauregard grabs the gum that she's not supposed to, and Wonka keeps telling her to stop chewing, and she turns into a blueberry. As is, yeah, pretty much different. And then both, basically, they roll her off to be squeezed, and her parents are dragged along with her. And it's like, yes, and then again, the Oompa Loompas sing about her chewing gum and how disgusting it is and stuff like that. And it gets a little morbid. I think they talk about a woman dying because they're morbid. Moving on. And then you get to, now this is, I'll bring this up when I do the film reviews. The Wonka story, the Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory uses geese. The original story uses squirrels. And the monstrosity done by Johnny Depp also uses squirrels. The technology wasn't there when they did the Wonka story, so they used giant geese instead of squirrels. So in come the squirrels and the nuts. So Veruca sees squirrels that are trained to crack open nuts. I believe it's pistachios. And she wants one, and she tries. Basically, Wonka says they're not for sale. Her parents try to buy her one. She breaks in. She tries to grab a squirrel. They attack her, hold her down, knock on her head, proves that it's a bad nut because it's hollow. Apparently, her head is hollow, and dump her down the garbage chute. And then both of her parents end up following her, and the same thing happens. They're all dumped down the garbage chute. And yes, you get the whole one. It's like, maybe they're gonna get turned on the furnace and stuff like that. And basically, Wonka says, it's like, yeah, they're gonna be covered in garbage. It's like, how do you generate garbage? It's like, well, I don't eat nothing but cocoa or cacao leaves, which, and other things. So they end up being dumped down the garbage chute. Then you get to the elevator, and Mike TV, basically he says, where is there a television room here? And it's like, yes. And they go to the television room, and they go past some of the giant mountains, and you see a Oompa Loompa village and naked children running around. Yes, because he does actually talk about the clothing of the Oompaloos, who insist the men insist on wear they insist on wearing their traditional clothing. The men wearing deer skin, the women wearing leaves, and the babies wearing nothing. Yes, we're still in the problematic area of this book. It was written in 1964. Not that this is an excuse, but still, issues. Moving on. And this is also the dawn of television, which might explain the next situation. So Mike TV, they get to the TV room where Wonka is basically being able to move chocolate by television with the point of using this technology so people could sample his chocolate through their TVs. People didn't fully understand TVs yet. These were still relatively new. And I don't think they even have the possibility to do that now. And then Mike TV, of course, wants to go on television, and Wonka tries to stop him, and then he's transported. And it's mentioned that some of the chocolate bars have only come back half chocolate bars. So his parents are rightfully freaking out. He does come back. He's put back together. He's very, very small. And they basically have to send him off. And he's ranting and raving. He's like, I can sit around and watch TV all day. It's like his father's like, when we're getting home, the TV's going out the window. No more TV ever again. And then they take him off to be stretched. So, and I don't think the father puts him in his pocket. And they take him off to be stretched. And then it's like Charlie's the only one left. And Wonka's like, you're the only one left. And you have earned the best prize of all. So they go back to the elevator and they go out the window. And he's like, Wonka's like, I'm an old man. I don't have any children. You are now my heir. So I'm going to, I wanted this so I could find a child who wouldn't be selfish and who I could essentially groom, it's an ugly word, but yes, groom to a stent, to basically take care of the Oompa-Loompas and do everything my way and run my factory my way. And not, I don't know if it's implied that Charlie will ever be able to do anything new, but essentially run his, he wants a child so he can mold them into a version of himself, and run his factory his way rather than doing it through an adult lens. So he doesn't want to give it to another adult. So, and it shows them going and crashing through his family's roof and getting his parents and going up in the great glass elevator. And that's the end. That's the happy story at the end of the book. Charlie's going to, except for of course they do see the other kids getting out. He does not kill them. So the salts are covered in garbage, and they can, and they basically all get a truck of candy. So yes, the salts are covered in garbage. Obviously alive, but they're perfectly fine, just kind of covered in garbage. Maybe a little bit smarter, doubtful, but. Augustus Gloop is now a lot skinnier because they squeezed him, so he's not really fat anymore. They don't see Mike TV very well. He comes out a little bit later. Virgo Gorgori is skinnier, but still purple, apparently for the rest of her life. He's just gonna be purple. Fun anecdote, and I'll probably say this in the Willy Wonka review. The actress who played her in Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory was, because of the dye they used, it came out of her pores for some time after that. So, but again, the character is apparently possibly permanently purple. That's her problem. And then Mike TV comes out, they kind of overstretched him. So he's very, very tall. But again, they're all alive and they all get their lifetime supply of candy. So, and Charlie and his family get the chocolate factory. And that is actually the end of this book. Charlie and the Great Glass Elevator goes into stranger places. So, overview. This book has issues. The whole slavery of the Oompa Loompas thing. Which again, I lean toward Aborigines rather than Africans, but God knows if no, chocolate came from South America, not Australia. But he mentions eucalyptus leaves, so he's trying to make this strange. And again, the creatures he mentions do not exist, let alone having a people having to live off caterpillars. But he ships them over in boxes with holes in them, mentioning children and things. So, this book is weird. It's Roald Dahl. Most of his books are very, very. So, before you read it to your children, one, read it yourself and see if you want to actually read this to your children or have them read it and have a slavery discussion of why you don't actually smuggle human beings in boxes with holes in them into your country and pay them in cocoa beans and experiment on them. Though, hopefully, this is self-explanatory. That you should not do this, and possibly talk about Roald Dahl and imperialism just a little bit. It's weird. Age range. Wow, the slavery thing makes things weird. Late elementary, you do again talk about the slavery issue. Before this, again, it should be common sense. Most children should acknowledge that you shouldn't be shipping people in, smuggling people into the country in small crates with holes in them. No matter how small they are, along with an entire, basically an entire tribe of people, and then feeding them cocoa beans, which are actually very, very bitter. If you've ever tasted baking chocolate, which is almost a pure cacao, and contains a decent amount of caffeine, and again, I've tasted like 77% chocolate. It's disgusting. It's just extremely bitter. But again, he also experiments on them, and it's very, very weird. Oh, I do mention you do the fizzy lifting drink is something they mentioned, though Charlie and Uncle Joe have nothing to do with it, as opposed to adding drama to the Willy Wonka film. I will get there. I will cover both of those films, the Willy Wonka, which I grew up with, and the monstrosity that is what happens when you add Johnny Depp to things. But we will get there. Overall, it's an interesting little book. The more I reread Roald Dahl, the more I realize he was a very, very good horror author, and his books are really, really weird. They're just weird. So, highly recommend parents, please read this first before you choose to read it to your children. As much as he seems to be a classic children's author, there's so many issues with these books. Check out my George's Marvelous Medicine book. I will be covering James and the Giant Peach at some point, as well as the film. Thankfully, the films bypass the slavery issue, though they don't fully explain the Oompa Loompas in their singing. So thankfully they bypass that. Apparently it was supposed to possibly would have been worse. Roald Dahl has a very war had a very, 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 very warped mind. So interesting book, has some issues. Like most Roald Dahl books, there are issues. Late elementary, into probably middle school would be my earliest recommendation because, again, you have issues. Little kids might enjoy this, but they're not gonna. That whole slavery issues is what's stopping me from reading, from recommending this to small children. You can choose. I mean, in general, it's designed for children that young, but, discuss the weird slavery issue if you can. Otherwise, maybe first grade if you want to read this aloud. Younger kids, but again, slavery issues. I can't get over the slavery issues. When I reread this book, it's like, oh dear God, what was going on in this man's mind? You probably don't want to know. I've seen pictures, you see the Wikipedia pictures of Roald Dahl. He doesn't look like a nice person, as opposed to, say, Dr. Seuss, who was actually a nice person. But that is it for this review. I'm going to stop rambling about the insanity of Roald Dahl. Check out my introduction to Roald Dahl, where I ramble more about Roald Dahl, or Marvel's Laws of Medicine, where again, more rambling about the craziness of Roald Dahl. I will cover James and the Giant Peach along with the films. I have a bunch of other stuff that's not the insanity of Roald Dahl. Various other more appropriate children's books, some various films, both children's and teen and family films, a sprinkling of travel videos, a sprinkling of homeschooling stuff, so and a whole bunch more planned. So be sure to like and subscribe and check out my channel. Thank you.